So the chairperson for the session will be Dr. G.B. Gupta, Vice Chancellor, Pandit Deen Dayal, Upadhyay Memorial Health Sciences and Ayush University, Chhattisgarh. Sir, please come over, sir. And the speakers for the session are Dr. Geetanjali Bhatmanabhane, Director AIMS, Bhuvaneshwar. Yes. And the next speaker is Dr. P.V. Vijayaraghavan, Vice Chancellor, Sri Ramachandra University, Chennai. And another speaker is Professor K.R. Sethuraman, Vice Chancellor, Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, Puducherry. And also, yeah. And I also invite the panelists. The first lead panelist is Professor Raj Bahadur, Baba Farid University of Health Sciences, Punjab. The second lead panelist is Dr. V.K. Pandya, Vice Chancellor, People's University, Bhopal. The third lead panelist is Professor Arvind Rajwanshi, Subdean, PGIMER, Chandigarh. There is another session in this series, and the speaker is Dr. Purnima Baliga, Pro Vice Chancellor, Manipal Academy of Higher Education. This side, madam. This side. And the lead panelist is Professor S. Manian, Vice Chancellor, Annamalai University. Professor S. Manian. And the panelists for this session are. Dr. Jayalakshmi, Dean SLIMS, Puducherry, as panelist. Dr. V.V. Unnikrishnan, Dean Academics, Kerala University of Health Sciences. And Professor Vinita Das, Dean Faculty of Medicine, KG Medical College, Lucknow. That completes the panel. I now request Dr. G.B. Gupta, Vice Chancellor, to take over as the panelist.
Good evening, all learned vice chancellors, academicians, and health educationists who have arrived from all over the country. Now we are heading towards third session of today's roundtable meeting, and the theme of this third session is curriculum, pedagogy, assessment, and application of technology. This session will have three talks. First will be on curriculum. Second will be on role of information technology. And third session will be on teachers training. Now I will request Dr. Geetanjali to give her talk on need for instruction on patient safety, ethics, and professionalism in medical curricula at all the levels of education. Dr. Geetanjali.
Chairman Dr. Gupta, Professor Ravi Kumar, members of the distinguished audience. It's a privilege to be here for me to share with you some of my thoughts on this topic. In the next 10 minutes, I will just briefly go through these 5 points. Do we need to teach patient safety, ethics, and professionalism? What will happen if it is not taught? What is being done in India? how and what should be taught, and the challenges and the way forward. So the first question is there a need to teach patient safety, ethics and professionalism? I'm sure some of you might have gone through Charaka's Oath of Initiation, which was written at least 2 centuries before the Hippocratic Oath. And this contains all the principles of ethics, professionalism, and patient safety, which means that these principles were already part of medicine in ancient India. So there is no need for us to debate whether there is a need for instruction. Obviously there is. And we will not think about whether we need to teach. We need to teach it. But let's just take a look at what will happen if it is not taught. Almost every month, or at least twice a month, we have these things come up. Either a doctor is thrashed, or the doctors beat patients' relatives, or sometimes the patients. Doctors are shown in very bad light about how we have become the pharmaceutical industry's mouthpiece, and so on. Right? We all know about it. So there is no point in going about what will happen if it is not taught. This is going to become worse. There are a lot of advantages to teaching ethics and professionalism. However, we can't kid ourselves that this is going to happen overnight. And if we do teach it, it's not going to change everything under the sun. But we think that it might minimize ethical or professional misconduct. It may reduce criminal or civil medical negligence to some extent, because students will be better informed, doctors will be better informed. Sometimes, because we are able to teach people how to communicate better, we may be able to prevent or lessen the number of physical assaults by the public. Of course, the public image of the profession will be improved right now, or the public image of the profession is almost at its lowest. We also hope that it will foster a sense of service and empathy in the doctors. In a similar manner, teaching the advantages of teaching patient safety, well brought out in this systematic review. It's a little old, it's about 7 years old, but it gives all the points. It would reduce iatrogenic morbidity and mortality, probably reduce compensation claims, and of course it will improve the level of trust between patients and healthcare providers. So the advantages are many. They may not be tangible at first, but slowly but surely there will come a change. So let me just tell you whether it is being done in India. It's not that we have not been doing anything at all. That's not true. The Indian medical regulations by the Medical Council of India, in 2002, they brought out a booklet, Professional Conduct, Etiquette and Ethics Regulations. And every time somebody registers with the Medical Council of India, they're given a booklet. The only problem is nobody reads it. But it's actually an extremely good document, very well written. It lists out, you know, the entire code of conduct. The Vision 2015 document, again by the MCI, or the 2012 Graduate Medical Education, has so many opportunities which list exactly what is expected, the competencies expected of an Indian medical graduate. It gives in details how and when we can teach ethics, professionalism, communication skills and so on, leadership and all these soft skills, so to speak. The other thing which they came out is with what is called an ATCOM module in 2015. The Attitudes and Communication Model, prepared by the MCI, not only they prepared a workbook, but they also conducted the training required for medical educators or medical teachers, and I think they trained 5 people from each college who will be able to take this forward and implement it at different medical colleges. So they thought this thing through, so we have to give them that credit for having done it. Now many institutions have implemented to a large or smaller extent, sensitization programs, workshops, some modules on ethics, professionalism, at all levels of training. So this is something which we must acknowledge. For example, UCMS has introduced medical humanities, and I know in JIPMER we do, throughout the year we do some work or yadi on this. There are private medical institutions which do this to a large extent. We have seen different examples of people coming out with what they are doing. So it is being done in different institutions. Some don't do it, some do. I'll just give you an example from one department, and I belong to pharmacology, and I was in Jipmer, Pondicherry for almost all my professional life. So I can say that during the first year, what we used to do is we used to borrow time from anatomy department, and that was because my husband was an anatomist, so it was easy for me to flick some hours from him. And we used to show video on unethical practices, and then we used to have this discussion. And in first year, students have these stars in their eyes, and it's so easy to get them involved in some kind of a discussion on ethics and professionalism. Once they come into pharmacology in the third semester, we used to have a debate on animal ethics and how important it is to actually do animal research for progress in medical education, medical science. We used to have this debate where we used to get two sides, we used to give them the some background information, and we used to conduct this debate on animal ethics. We used to teach them informed consent. You know, the principles of informed consent, the element of informed consent, and so on. Not just from research perspective, but also for practice as well as for taking consent for use of some drugs which can cause harm. We used to teach them about critical appraisal of drug advertisements, especially the unethical drug advertisements which are rampant in some of the journals which we see. We used to talk about ethics in human research, medication safety, prescription audit. We introduced this after Professor Ravi Kumar became our director, because that was the time when we were all introduced and sensitized into taking up safety as a topic. So we introduced this after he joined as a director. Good clinical practice, communicating to patients regarding medicines, and so on. During internship, Professor Sethuraman is here. They have prepared a beautiful video on how to deal with medical reps and how to use this, not just to get information which is misleading, but also how to learn from it. Now, all these topics are taught during the practical classes. So we didn't get any extra curricular time. We inbuilt it into our curriculum, and they were all formally assessed, both during summative examination as well as during formative examinations. So the question is how and what to teach. Now, if you look or just Google up ethics undergraduates teaching, it will come up with at least these three: module for teaching medical ethics to undergraduates, orientation of master trainers on teaching medical ethics, and the facilitator's guide. If you go through these things, you will realize that it's almost like ethics for dummies, you know. So you don't need any more content to be able to teach ethics and professionalism. It's already been done. So there's no point in reinventing the wheel when you have such a fantastic thing. Only thing is, you may need to adapt and adopt it to your own curriculum, which we can easily do. So that's something which is there, and it's just not from WHO, but you'll find lot of information from Australia, from UK, and different parts of the world. The same thing comes for patient safety. The two guides which have come out from WHO are excellent guides, which if any educator goes through it, they will have enough material to be able to teach with confidence. But the problem is, we are only looking at undergraduate teaching. We have not addressed postgraduate teaching, and this is because many times we believe that postgraduates have to imbibe, you know, all the qualities, that the teachers will be very ethical and professional and so on and so forth. But most of the specialties, and especially super specialties, there are a lot of nuanced things which need to be taught, and the issues will be very, very focused to that specialty, and this is something which we are not addressing much. So if I talk about the challenges, this used to be that problem some time back, but luckily now becoming a medical educator has become a kind of, you know, a crown which everyone wants to wear, because people feel that you want to be associated with medical education, which was not the scene about 2 decades ago, when everyone said that, oh, if you were not a good surgeon, then you became a medical educator kind of a thing. So the challenge is, you need to train our faculty to be able to teach these subjects. That's the main challenge, because the teaching learning methods which are not normally used will be used for these topics. We have to use debates, videos, reflective writing, role plays, audits. And the issue is, it's not very easy to teach reflective writing if the faculty themselves don't know to write. And when we conducted these workshops for the faculty, I used to take a session on reflective writing. I used to just ask the faculty, okay, I used to give them time, overnight task, and say, please reflect on this issue and write 250 words, 300 words. And, you know, there will be barely, in about 30 people, there will be barely one or two who can write a decent reflection. So we need to teach them how to use this. Similarly, techniques of debriefing, using blame-free tools of reporting, feedback, these things we are not familiar with. Many times, faculty have come and said, oh, I've used this video and this is very nice, students liked it. But actually what happens is they only show the video. There is no debriefing. And if there is no effective debriefing, there is no point in having used that video in the first place. The third challenge is assessments. Unless we assess, nobody is going to bother about this. So we have to assess these topics which we are teaching. And of course this, I touched on it previously. Postgraduates and super specialty trainees, how to teach, how to assess, and some people will say, where is the time? That is not an excuse. We have to introduce this into their curriculum. So I'll just leave you with three thoughts. The way forward is, first, we have to promote a culture of patient safety, ethical behavior, and professional conduct. And there is no way we can get out of this if we don't promote a culture of that. Right from greeting a person, being civil, it's very important that this culture is promoted. That is the only way our trainees will also be able to imbibe a little bit. Second is implementing the content, patient safety, ethics, professionalism, everything into the pre-existing curricula. Forget about having something separate. Forget about having extra time. You are not going to get it. Within the pre-existing curricula, it can be done. I've just given example. I have in your handouts, you will find that I have put what we hope to do in AIIMS Bhubaneswar. So you can just take a look at that. So this has to be done. We also need to provide faculty training, not just how to teach or facilitate, but also on how to assess, different assessment methods for assessing students on these three topics. So this is my message for today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam, for giving a nice lecture. Now, from her talk, two, three points have clearly emerged out. First is issue of patient safety. Patient safety, which can be subsequently evaluated, as told very nicely by the speaker, that if you have given patient safety measures, or given safety to the patients, we will find that there will be reduction in number of clashes between doctors and patients, which she has shown in the first slide. And then there is an improvement in the trust between the patient and the doctor. And definitely, iatrogenic mortality and morbidity will go down. Second point, she has told nicely that ethics must be taught to our students. What is very important is that regarding ethics, most of the universities and most of the teachers and colleges are at present not including in any form in the teaching. But it must form a very important part of curriculum right from first year. And it should go up to final year, internship, and then there should be a potentiation of your ethical training before you start post-graduation. Third thing she has very correctly said, that the ethics not only applies on human beings, but also on animals when you are using them for your experiments. Now the lead panelist, Professor Ramesh, has not come probably. So I will request Dr. Raj Bahadur to please say a few words, his opinion on this issue.
Madam has essentially given what I was expected to speak. But what I am going to say now is, the Vice Chancellor, those who are sitting here, they are almost of age of 60. They are as a vice chancellor because they have followed the ethics in their total curriculum as well as their career. What we see today is a dummy admission in a school, and they are doing coaching in the coaching center. You and me were in his college doing 10 plus 2 or a BSc's, and then we used to enter into the medical college. Now it is a dummy admission. The very character of the parents as well as the student is different. After doing the dummy admissions, the type of entrance examination which we have conducted, NEET examination which I have conducted, we have seen in the north that the student who has entered into the medical profession is with 20% marks. When you and me were studied, the 50% they were minimum. Even if we have done the NEET examination, the substance which we have taken to produce a best doctor is with 20% marks. As well as the percentage is concerned, even if the percentile may be 50 percentile. So we have to be cautious as a vice chancellors and to see the future generation of the doctors, those who are coming, are what type of doctors. So it is very important, as my madam has mentioned, there is high time that we start spending time on the students for teaching them the ethics. The other day I was sitting in the PGI, which is national importance. Myself, head of department of psychiatry, and the medical superintendent was standing. A doctor of senior resident neurology comes, talks to the patients, goes back and tells that I'm sitting there and come for the discharge slip. That's the relation which the students has with the senior faculty. On the other day, I, as a vice chancellor and the previous director of one of the GMCH Medical College Chandigarh, gave an injection, epidural injection, to a patient who was the father of a previous director. The news item was that without the permission, the previous director has given injection to the father of another director, even if I have taken a verbal permission from the present director. So what I wish to convey to you is, on the side of the students, the relation between the students and the three senior persons, those are sitting along with the patient, was that. And similarly on this side, our own faculty, they're talking in the media that a vice chancellor who was the previous director of the institution has given an injection to another father of a previous director without the permission. So the ethics as such, they are fast dwindling. It is a high time that we should react on this. Otherwise, I believe that the scene is going to be very bad, and it all would be responsible, as far as we are concerned, as a faculty would be responsible to see that this must improve. We are following the Hippocrates oath and the ethics which is given in that, and the same is given in the Medical Council of India. In our own charka, where madam has just referred, has said, Kwachid Maitri, this is in Sanskrit, Kwachid Maitri, Kwachid Arth, Kwachid Dharma, Kwachid Yash. The meaning is, at time the friends will not help you. At time the money will not help you. At time the religion will also not help you. And at time the yash which you have gained will also not help you. The only thing, it is a karma abhyasa. Karma abhyasa is the one he requests to the God, is the one which is going to give the benefit. Always give the benefit. Chikitsa nishfal nasti. If you have worked hard on the patient, is the one which is going to give the fruit always. Whereas these four things for which we are working hard, for friendship, we do unethical thing. For yash, we do unethical things. For money, we do unethical things. For religion, we are doing unethical things. So we as a medical profession should see to it that the professionalism and the patient safety and the ethics should be of the side which Charka has said in our scripture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Rajbahadurji. Now, questions from the house.
Dr. N.R. Vishwas, I am Director and Vice Chancellor, Indira Gandhi Institute, Patna. The first slide, now what discussed that why there is a clash in the particular say in the emergency. The intern nowadays, they are busy only tracking the MCQ. They hardly treat the patients. They are now mechanical doctors. All depends on MRI or CT scan and everything. They don't go to the patients. They are insensitive to the cause of the patients. Patients are dying and they are reading their MCQ book. They are not skilled doctors. So this is the high time now we have to address this thing, how we can make them good doctors, human doctors. Thank you.
Anybody else? Please.
Pandya, Vice Chancellor, People's University, Bhopal. Just for your kind information, University Grants Commission has already started one module course of 48 hours, 1 hour per week for ethics and core values in undergraduate duration, and 45 hours for theory and 3 hours for practical. So that is quite beneficial, and most of the universities, I think, they have already drawn this as an optional subject, non-credit. 6 months module course by University Grants Commission. Thank you so much.
What the US is doing for last almost 25 years, we are not willing to understand that there is no value of teaching if there is no exam. In UK, US, passing in comm skills, passing in professionalism is mandatory, is a separate exam. Without this, people will not go further. So we have to understand, not only we have to teach, it's a mandatory exam. Yes.
Last comment.
Good evening, sir. Dr. Vatsala Swami from D.Y. Patil, Pune. I was interacting with Madam Purnima, I think, in the afternoon. Any amount of including it in theory about professionalism and ethics is not going to help. Being a director of academics, I interact with both faculty and students. And what I realized is, right from first year when we charity begins at home. So when we start doing it in a practical manner, telling them when they go wrong, madam said in the afternoon that somebody was abusing the patient, immediately you correct it as a faculty, then only it will be effective. That's what I feel. And not only correcting and seeing to it, or to tell what is right, whether it is faculty or students. Yes. What is right and what is wrong, that is very important.
Okay, now sir, Kalra sir.
Although I agree with madam, she just said that the ethical values and principles are taught right from the cradle by parents and then the school teachers. But when it comes to medical professionalism and ethics, although those core values are important, but then the ethical values also have to be examined in the light of various technological advances which are taking place. For example, the ethical part of organ transplantation, the ethical part of in vitro fertilization, surrogacy act, these are technical things which, and even PCP and DT act, unless and until our doctors, they are taught these things in a formal manner in the medical college, they may be meaning right, but then unintentionally they will get into trouble and they'll find it difficult to come. So for us to ensure that the students are taught, these must be incorporated in the curriculum by the respective councils, whether it's medical council, dental council, pharmacy council. We have already written these. The pharmacy council and the dental council have already adopted and included in their curricula. Medical council is yet to do it.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir,
now we are running short of time. Now the final comments are like this. We are following the fixed curriculum in most of the universities, and most of the times it is guided, fully copied with full stop and comma as per council. But the university has right to keep on improvising its curriculum. Minimum what is suggested may be adapted, but it should keep on improvising curriculum regularly. Now this will mean deletion of some of the things and inclusion of some of the things. And some of the things will need widening. For example, nowadays in viral disease, you have to teach AIDS quite a lot. Next thing in curriculum, there can be a regional component also, because we know that some of the diseases are prevalent in some of the regions. And students should not be deprived of such kind of facility of clinical material which they are having in their area. For example, in some of the areas, sickle cell disease is very, very common. So the students must be taught much more about sickle cell in that area. For example, in one of the area, cancers are very common. So in that type of location or that state, that medical college may focus more on cancer, more devote more lectures on that. And this all has to be done in local level by the university in addition to fixed curriculum. Now, as far as ethics is concerned, one must teach a student right from the day one, please do no harm to the patient. You may give no benefit to the patient is all right, but please do not harm to the patient. That is very, very important. And postgraduates, we have seen as soon as they become doctor, internship, as our colleague has already said nicely, they are looking after all MCQs during their internship, and suddenly they become doctor. They are put on night duty. First day they have to certify death, and they do not know how to certify it. So what I feel is that all ethics and induction programs for postgraduates must be adapted. And now we are going for the second part of this curriculum session, that is competency-based curriculum development. Dr. Bijay Raghavan, Vice Chancellor, Ramchandra University, Chennai, will be giving talk on this. Dr. Bijay Raghavan.
Good evening, respected Vice Chancellors from the health universities across the country. While I'm just waiting the slides to get ready, I just wanted to quote the experience that we have at Ramchandra in terms of this ethics education. We have got a program called ProDev, Professional Development, which what we actually do is, it's a case-based type of a training that we give. A case scenario is presented, and the students are allowed to collect resources on their own, given 2 weeks' time, and they come back for a group discussion where the issues that were concerning that particular subject is discussed. And we have a formative assessment. Every three issues, we have a formative, and it has worked very well. So we have to teach ethics, otherwise it is a very abstract subject and students usually will not get interested, and we should probably practice some other mode of an educational technology. I bring greetings from Sri Ramchandra University, Chennai, and I also would like to thank Dr. Ravi Kumar and his team for providing this opportunity to give some of the basics of competency-based curriculum development and also what we do practice in our own institution. We all know that when our students enter into a medical college, they are in a stage of unconscious incompetence. That is, if they do not know the skill and they do not know how much proficient they are. From this, they move on to a stage, probably in the third year or maybe even final year, into a conscious incompetence, where they know that they do not know or they cannot do, and still they accept it. Actually, we should aim to push them, at least in the final year, to a stage of conscious competence, where they know that they know it, they know that they can do it, and they should be able to do it, at least during internship. Ideally, probably we should get into the unconscious competence stage, which probably happens towards post-graduation. Now, even the MCI had quite a lot of confusions about competency-based education. When they started this effort, actually, I don't know how many of you had gone through the Dhawan's report. He indicated competency-based education for postgraduates. It was not even mentioned for undergraduates. So all the effort had gone into postgraduate education. Probably we need to look at that as well, because some of our postgraduates really don't get that type of education. But now we are looking at competency-based education at the undergraduate level, and a lot of work has happened, and it is just waiting for the approval of the Ministry of Health. MCA has already passed on this document, and it is just waiting to be approved. So the objectives of my talk today would be to just clarify what do we mean by competence and competency and competency-based education. What is the background? Why should we do it? We keep asking. We all learn through the traditional curriculum. What is so wrong with us? What is so wrong with us? So we have become good doctors. We do have patient safety concerns. So this is a question that always will be asked, particularly by the group which is assembled here, to the youngsters, whether this is essential or not. There are various competency framework networks in medical education. We will talk a little bit about some other countries. And what is the basic difference between traditional versus competency model, and how do we actually develop a competency-based curriculum? Now, this is the competency is something, the ability to do something, any task. And ideally, the best definition that I could get from literature is the one provided by Epstein, where he says the competency is something which is the habitual and judicious use of communication, knowledge, technical skills, clinical reasoning, emotions, values, and reflection. There are almost seven different components that you are supposed to have assessed the student before you certify him as an MBBS graduate. Are we doing this? Is something which we have to reflect. Now, competency-based education is an approach in to preparing physicians for practice on the society or on the community that we serve. Now, are we doing this, and do we provide the academic flexibility towards doing this? Now, ACGME, that is the American Council for Graduate Medical Education, is the one which defined this almost 20, 25 years back. And the competencies that they defined were patient care, interpersonal relationship, professionalism, practice-based medical practice, and medical knowledge. But see, we seem to be always loading the students with medical knowledge over and over again without providing other opportunities. The GMC, that defined competency in a different format. They said that at the end of the graduate program, the doctor should be a scientist, he should be a practitioner, and he should be a professional. And for doing this, they have given some outcome criteria which needs to be followed. And the Canadian Medical Association came up with almost seven different criteria for somebody to be called competent, and those are also put up on the slide. So in a competency-based curriculum, if you have to develop one, we need to first identify the competencies that a student should have achieved at the end of the program. Describing whether he has achieved or not, how do we assess? We should have some interestable professional activity that should have been defined. How much can you trust a graduate in doing a particular procedure? That's why when the MCA came up with this document, and we had this discussion even during the previous session, we suggested every medical college is not the same. Every medical college does not have the same facilities. Every medical college does not have the same faculty. At least ask each medical college to come up with six basic competencies: giving an IM injection, giving an IV injection, taking an informed consent. Come with some six competencies which each institution can be asked to define on their own, and ask every single student of theirs whether they have performed this or not. Because if you start defining all the competencies, it will come to about 1,000 competencies overall. But if you can achieve six, and for the next year go for the next six, I think it will do wonders. And we need to describe some milestones as well. Now, in competency-based education, basically the difference is that in a traditional one, it is time-based. Whereas here, the learner determines the time when he will learn this. The assessment method is more formative in the competency-based, whereas in the traditional one, they go for summative. And the faculty decides when he has to go for an exam in a traditional method, whereas the student decides when he is ready to go for the competency-based assessment. So this is how the two important systems differ. And we need to follow the six-step approach of David Kern in order to develop a competency-based curriculum. Conduct a needs assessment. Every different area has got different need. So get stakeholder opinion from the students, from the public, from the faculty, from even the administrators, and then develop this competency-based curriculum. You may find that in a government hospital, giving an intramuscular injection is not a great competency. I think something, it will happen every single student will be able to do it. But you have to define it according to that. Identify the competencies addressed by a particular rotation or a particular posting, and then ask them to do it. Write down the objectives and goals, determine the appropriate teaching methods, have an appropriate assessment tool to measure it, and then determine the program improvement as a result of this. And this program improvement is something which you can't see it overnight. You would see the batch of students which go out and practice, you would know what they are good at and what they are not good at. And we probably have to follow the device model of actually taking them through from a novice to an expert stage, as is mentioned here. So the needs assessment between the two, how is it different? In the traditional curriculum, educational objectives are already defined by MCI. And based on those educational objectives, you make the student assessed and they learn it accordingly. Whereas in a competency-based curriculum, you define the health needs and the health systems which the patient requires. Based on that, you define the competencies, and based on that, you develop the curriculum and give the appropriate training and do the assessment. Now, this is the basic difference. You work backward in order to get your students to be competent in the area. The identification of competencies are by different methods. You can peruse the medical records, you can seek the stakeholder feedbacks, you can see as analysis of physician activities that are required to be done, and you can develop it that way. And these are the various components that you have to look at: the knowledge component, the skills component, and the attitudinal component, and what you expect your student to come out of this. I'll just give some of the examples. We had the opportunity to help the MCI in actually creating this competency document. I will give only the five roles that a doctor is supposed to fulfill. First is as a clinician. For that, one of the competencies mentioned is demonstrate. That means he has to show ability to choose the appropriate diagnostic tests and interpret these tests. It cannot be achieved by a theory exam. He has to do a practical training in order to do this based on scientific validity, cost effectiveness, and clinical. And you can change this. It's not absolute that the competency has to remain the same. It can be changed. Role as a leader: work effectively and appropriately with colleagues in an interprofessional healthcare team. How he interacts with the nurse, how he interacts with the pharmacist is something which you can put to an exercise and make him do. Role as a communicator: how he communicates with the patients, colleagues, families, all these things can be looked at. As a lifelong learner, how much he keeps in touch with the journals and with the literature available, and he's able to correlate that for patient care. It's no point, he keeps reading 24 hours a day but does not open his mouth in front of the patient. And role as a professional: whether he maintains integrity, whether he maintains selflessness, all these aspects has to be checked. It is not easy to assess, but it is something which we need to look at. The right goals and objectives is another thing that we will start doing based on the competencies. Each competency may have 25 objectives, but start writing down and then make your students learn that. Let the students know transparently what is it that you expect out of them. Then the content identification, this is where we keep fighting. Each subject specialist will come and say this is important, that is important, but you need to organize that in the form of course organization, time organization, define the desired level of mastery or the competency that a person should have achieved, define the milestones. I have given on the right side, it's very difficult to read that part, but for every single competency, you have to mention the level up to which he is supposed to achieve and at what phase of the curriculum he should have achieved this. Assessment, very important component for competency-based curriculum. This is almost the backbone. And the important thing here is feedback, and the important here is formative assessment. Your summative assessment, MCA may not permit you to do a lot of things for the next 25 years. But the formative assessment is very well within the purview of the individual institution or the university, and you can make all these things in terms of student selection, in terms of the faculty has to be developed. You can't today say that you will practice mini CX in an area when your faculty is not trained to do that. Even OSCE development becomes very difficult when it is introduced without training. So these are some of the things that one needs to work at. Define the performance criteria, select the assessment method that you want to choose, and also look at whether it has worked or not. If all your 100 students have failed in a particular assessment method, there is something wrong with your assessment method. So please look at your, there should be a constant feedback and reflection on what you have developed. And this is the final program evaluation where you must be able to get an idea of the learner satisfaction, of the patient health outcomes, performance. This is something you cannot. Now, we started the integrated curriculum in Ramachandra in 2006. For us to see the effect of this, it took almost 8 years. In 2014 only, we were able to see that our students probably are performing better than many other colleges. And they also choose Ramachandra for the educational value that we give. So this is something you have to look, and the learning outcome for an individual student. This is the document how you prepare. You put the competency down, which domain it belongs to, what level you want them to achieve that, and in what time, whether it's a core area or non-core area, and what is map it to the global competency, whether it's a clinician-oriented one, or a team member-oriented one, or a lifelong learner, you have to sort of chart out. Luckily, I must inform all the vice chancellors assembled here, the medical council has done phenomenal work over the last 3 years. They have come out with this document, which already has identified the competencies, and keeping in view the Indian culture, they have done it subject-wise. They have done it subject-wise for all the 21 subjects. Now it is for individual vice chancellors to insist upon their deans to take this document when it is approved by the Ministry of Health and start practicing this on the ground. Then you will find a lot of things may have to undergo amendments and changes. That is somehow which we should. And then linking this competency to the appropriate, this has been left to the individual institution. How exactly you want that competency to be taught, what method you should use, or what is the assessment worksheet that you should use, is something which you can work out. And the milestone worksheet is something like this, where you define the competency, what is the milestone, and what levels at which they should reach this, what is the critical deficiency. No student in this competency-based curriculum ever fails. What you tell him is, you clear this exam in another 3 months. You go and get more trained, come back, and then do it. So a student probably may clear MBBS, that is already allowed by MCI. They can allow a person to even pass his MBBS at the age of 60. That's the present ruling. So when that is the rule, you can very well create a competency-based curriculum based on that principle and allow students to graduate as and when they have done the particular requirement. And this is the cycle that you follow. You identify the general competencies, define the specific competencies, sir, this is the last slide, sir. Establish criteria for performance, outline the acceptable learning methods, what is the assessment that you would use, and finally evaluate, refine, and repeat. So this is the cycle that one needs to do. I would like to just quote that SRU has a great experience in doing competency-based curriculum for the BSc nursing program within the purview of the Nursing Council of India. The problem is we do not read the documents what has been provided. We criticize MCI so much, but if you see the 1997 regulations, you would find that it is allowing quite a lot of these principles even in that document. But we need to read every word of what is given there and utilize the positive points for a particular institution. The other thing is facilitating the MCI in terms of developing this document, we were able to play a part. And the ATCOM module about which Dr. Geeta just talked about is something which also originated with a lot of inputs from Ramachandra. Thank you for the opportunity provided.
Thank you, Professor. Now I will invite Dr. Pandya for his comments.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm thankful to Professor Ravi Kumar for inviting all of us here and giving us chance to participate in such academic feast. I'm thankful to him for inviting me as, appointing me as panelist also. Honorable Chairperson, Dr. G.B. Gupta, and all my fellow colleagues and speakers. I'm thankful to Dr. Vijay Raghavan from MGR Medical University, Chennai. He has already put lot of, he has given us a very deliberate knowledge about competency-based curriculum development. Just I wanted to add one thing, that although MCI has put competency-based competencies in postgraduate medical education, but even in undergraduate medical regulations, they had put the goals for internship training. Now already Medical Council of India has applied so many interdisciplinary exchanges of knowledge in medical institutions, like applied radiological anatomy, or clinical physiology, or pharmacovigilance, or prescription audits for pharmacology. So already if we follow that interdepartmental training in undergraduate level, I think lot of development of the curriculum and some module change are possible. Now in other health sciences universities like pharmacy or nursing, paramedical and other dental institutes, we can do exercises for competency based development of curriculum. Now, just few slides, sir, to be added, if you kindly permit, Honorable Chairperson. The competency, it is the ability to perform and function independently in professional practice. Then competency should include more than facts only. They represent the integration and application of learned facts, skills and affective qualities needed to serve the patient, the community and the profession. Habitual and judicious use of communication, knowledge, technical skills, clinical reasoning, emotions, values and reflections in daily practice for the benefit of the individual and community being served. Time and faith. Time-based students need a defined amount of time on task, a topic to become competent, but we really have no clue how much time it takes. Faith-based, take on faith that within a set time students will learn what they need to learn and miraculously become competent. So little evidence for that belief. So overarching goals for curricula are standardization of learning outcomes and individualization of the learning process, integration of formal knowledge and clinical experience, development of habits of inquiry and innovation, and focus on professional identity formation. So implications are competency outcomes drive curriculum objectives, curriculum does not drive outcomes, and fundamental shift from teacher-centered to learner-centered orientation. So these are the few slides which I have just dared to add on, although already Dr. Vijayaraghavan had put on all the details on his presentation. Thank you so much.
Any comments from the panelist side, please?
So I'm Dr. Vinita Das, Dean Medical from King George's Medical University. This competency-based curriculum actually is very good curriculum. My only concern is the students and the parents, they are not sensitized. So once on one side we say that once the student attain a particular competency at particular level, if the student has not achieved it, he can go further 3 months and can have some time, and once he or she achieves the competency, only then we can label him or her that she has passed that or she has attained that competency. So our system, our society has not been sensitized for this. So there is a stigma of failure and pass stigma. So until unless we sensitize the students and the parents and the community that until unless a person achieves a particular competency, because it is ultimately going to benefit the society, we are not going to, it will be very difficult to implement.
Now, we are running very short of time. So kindly one question from the audience, please.
Dr. Siddharth Das from KG Medical University, Lucknow. One question to Dr. Vijay Raghavan is a very small question. The document, the MCI document that you are saying, which is awaiting clearance from the government, is a draft copy available so that we could start preparing it?
Unfortunately, just Dr. Ved Prakash Mishra informed me, he is the sort of author of, as academic committee chairman, that we have now attained the patency right for this. Because if you don't get the patency right, there is a chance that some other country might copy it. So that took a lot of time. So he just informed me 1 or 2 weeks back that it has been approved. So it is probably in a month's time, it is going to be approved by the medical council itself, and you will be getting a copy of it. And as a person who has been involved in it, I can share a copy with you.
That would be fantastic. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Sir, to Madam's question, the faculty has already been trained towards this through the FIME as well as for the revised basic course, through the ADCOM module and things like that. A lot of faculty members have already been trained towards how to develop competencies and what methods they should choose and things like that. You are absolutely right. The parents, but they will understand it. Why? Because in school education, they have this. In school education, even though there is a summative assessment, I can tell you, if you follow this, your summative examination will become so easy. Just to quote our own example in our institution, when we introduced the integrated curriculum, everybody said your formative assessment is so different from the summative assessment and your students are not going to do well. In fact, I've had the feedback from all the external examiners. They did much better in terms of the final exam, because the students will learn the way you want them to learn. Assessment drives their learning. So how we sort of train them. So students will not be a problem. Parents could be a problem in those people where the competency has not been achieved, but they have to be educated that they have no more failed an exam. Now you just contact the parent who has failed the first MBBS first phase. You see their plight. They almost miss and they become an additional batch for life. That is how a lot of universities have got the system. Whereas here, nobody is called failed. He has been found not competent at this point in time. That's how the report will go. At this point in time, he has been found not competent in this particular competency. However, as soon as he completes, it need not be 3 months. It can be after 4 weeks. And once the faculty comes, but somebody pointed out in the morning, you need extra faculty members. Definitely this strength, what the MCI has approved, is not sufficient to do.
Thank you for the comments. Now, finally, we can understand like this, that competency-based learning is very important, and probably assuming final shape through MCI, and in a month or 2 months' time, it may be on the ground. Now, it's true that once we adopt it, it requires large numbers of teachers to be trained in teaching as well as in evaluation. And therefore, this part must be given full and due care so that once we adopt the system, we do not land into failure. Some of the institutions who have participated in preparing this program, they are quite advanced, but we have to look for another 400 colleges which are going to follow this system of competency. In competency, the one of the important factor is that it is almost like awarding driving license to a doctor. As when we go for driving license, you are tested for your action in real time and you have to achieve performance to a certain level. So this is very good one, but we have to have all resources put in to train the teachers. Now we are moving towards the second topic of this third session, that is role of information and technology, computation and adoption of curriculum, delivery and assessment. For this, the talk is to be given by Professor K.R. Sethuraman, Vice Chancellor, Sri Balaji Vidyapeeth, Pondicherry. Lead panelist will be Dr. Arvind Rajvanshi. Dr. Sethuraman, please.